Welcome to Calm 100, Mass Media and Society. I'm your instructor, Catherine Clinch. I bet I know where you were last Sunday. Like everybody else in almost the entire world, you were probably watching the Super Bowl. It's a global event. It's the biggest football game of the year, and it also is the biggest time for advertising, because it's reached the point where hundreds of millions of dollars will transfer hands because of the production and the space purchase of advertising time during the Super Bowl. It is the time when ads actually become a news story because the production values are so enormous and the stakes are so high. The funny ones are funny. The beautiful ones are beautiful. And here's the amazing thing. In an entire four-hour block of television, there wasn't a single ad for Stay Free Max pads. That leads us to our subject today, which is demographics. And we're going to be talking about how all of that plays into the way that advertising happens in media and the way that companies sell to you and the way that products speak to you, presumably in the way you want to be spoken to. As always, we have three learning objectives because this is course. So by the end of today, you'll be able to discuss the reasons behind audience segmentation by demographics. You'll also be able to explain the difference between demographics and psychographics. Finally, you'll understand how the media portrayal of women and children impacts the role of women and children in society. We'll specifically be talking about the role of women as mothers, and so, like any good television mother, I wore my pearls today. We do have some bookkeeping before we go on, because as you probably know by now, this class is part of the Applied Studies Bachelor's Degree Completion Program. Classes are broadcast live on this cable channel and webcast on the internet each week. This spring, we're broadcasting four classes. Political Science 335, which is International Politics, airs on Tuesdays from 7 to 9 p.m. Communications 100, Mass Media and Society, which is what you're watching now, is on Saturdays from noon to 1:40 p.m. But you probably figured that out by now, too. Communications 300, Organizational Communications, is on Saturday from 1:50 to 3:30 p.m. And Sociology 315, The Sociology of Work, is on Sundays from noon to 2 p.m. If you've completed the first 2 years of college, you could earn your bachelor's degree by enrolling in these classes. All the courses you need to complete your bachelor's degree will be broadcast over the next 2 years. And when we're finished, we'll start all over again so you have a chance to complete everything. If you'd like more information about the Applied Studies Bachelor's Degree Completion Program, please check out www.appliedstudies.tv or call 866-278-6789. Now, before we get started with the regular curriculum today, it is essential to note that we've been watching history unfold before our eyes in this past week. It is being called the Facebook Revolution in Egypt. It is a perfect demonstration of peaceful movements in order to change a government. The peaceful assembly of the Egyptian population in Cairo actually caused a complete transformation in the politics of a country and ultimately, we believe, the politics of a region. And it was done, they believe, because they were able to communicate to each other with Facebook. One of the pivotal activists was an executive from Google. He was detained for 10 days. Fortunately, he was released, but he has become one of the spokespersons. And as we've seen, media can transform the way that we see what is going on in a country, because when Anderson Cooper, who was one of my absolute heroes, was over in that region, he was beaten. He was assaulted. They showed footage of that on CNN repeatedly, and he left the region. And rightfully so. But a hero emerged. And that hero emerged because he understood the power of Facebook. And he said that he would like to meet Mark Zuckerberg now that this is over and thank him. And what we have to take note of is media has so much power now that it can indeed change the world. We have to consider the possibility that when they were saying all of the people who were assembling peacefully were able to speak to each other over Facebook and over mass media, well, so was the Egyptian military. And as we looked at the tanks, as we looked at the soldiers, and we were all hoping that violence would not break out, it didn't. So when we think of mass media, we have to always look at the global impact, and how it's being used to transform the world we live in. But now let's get back to what we're supposed to be talking about today, demographics. Demographics, simply stated, is the data that defines specific characteristics of a human population. Now, what's the reasoning behind demographics? Well, the sociology approach is that we have to understand ourselves so that we can study our culture and see where it's going. And one of the ways we do this is by quantifying information through demographics. It helps us in politics and public policy. It helps us with political constituents and the elected officials being able to understand who exactly they're serving and who exactly they're asking to vote for them. And the potential voters get a chance to understand how they fit into their community and who their representatives are indeed serving. We're going to see a little clip on that in a minute. But more relevant to our discussion is marketing demographics. Our job in marketing and in advertising is to convey a message and demonstrate our effectiveness in doing so. That's the point of view of the ad agencies and of the brands. And so marketing demographics want to know who's the customer and where do we find them. Now, step one in demographics is gathering the information. We're going to take a quick look at a clip from the census, and it'll explain how and why. Let's take a look.
We, the people of the United States.
The mandate for the census is right here, just a few sentences into the Constitution.
Representatives shall be apportioned among the several states according to their respective numbers.
Apportionment. The dividing of seats in the House of Representatives among the 50 states. But how does it actually work? Since the 1940 census, Congress has used the method of equal proportions, which follows this formula.
A sub n equals P over the square root.
Okay, don't worry about the math. Just think of the formula as an apportioning machine. First, the Constitution calls for each of the 50 states to have at least one seat. So subtract 50 from the current House total of 435, and you have 385 seats left. Next, the apportionment machine ranks the states by population according to the census. Then the machine starts giving out seats. After each seat is distributed, the machine re-ranks the remaining states based on the formula until all seats are distributed. This process ensures that each congressional district from Maryland to California has roughly the same number of people. In 1790, each House member represented only about 34,000 people. In 2000, each member represented on average 647,000 people. Since the first census, the decennial count has been the basis for our representative form of government. And as our country grows, the apportionment process ensures equal representation for all, just like the Founding Fathers planned. Apportionment, another gift from our nation's founders, who transformed the census from a tool of government into a tool of empowerment for the people.
So there you see, we have to do a census, and you probably remember we did one just a short while ago, because it happens every 10 years. And what do they ask you? They're looking for information on gender, race, age, income level, how many households have a person with disability, where do you live, what's your education level, do you own or rent, and what's your employment status? Now, all of that is not on the census, but that's certainly information that is sought demographically by our government in many, many different venues. Sometimes the information comes from kids in school that have forms that have to be returned. Now, the step two after having this is to analyze the trends. Okay, we're going to take a look right here now at the population trends in Buzzards Bay. Okay, let's go full screen for just a second. Because when we see this, what the government wants to know is how do populations and the demographics change over time? So you can see here, there are the growth of, here's the decline. And that's essential to note because they're going to lose representatives. And where is the biggest increase? In these areas over here. So they're going to get the most attention as far as government services. All right, let's go back. And what we have here is the ability now to examine our population in minute detail. And that's important because we select the bits of data that we're going to measure and we're comparing, and we're going to be able to formulate theories about what the data indicates. And that's essential because although it's open to subjective interpretation and debate, it gives us an idea of what we have to do in the coming years. Now, let's flash back to last year's lessons when we talked about, last week's lesson, seems like a year, of quantum theory physics. It is the minimum amount of any physical entity involved in an interaction. So the quantum demographic approach would be the selective measurement of arbitrary data. When we're looking at Heisenberg's uncertainty principle, again, we have to remember that the mere act of the more precisely one aspect is measured, the less precisely the other is measured. And this comes back to social media trends and all of the other things. We are looking at each individual in minute detail. The media is able to go into your Facebook page and understand so much more about you than you could ever imagine based on the friends you connect with, the choices you make, the games you participate in, and the links that you post. And you'll notice that the longer we're on Facebook, the more they seem to know about us. And that's not a bad thing. Certainly, some people feel that privacy is much more important than that, and they may choose not to be on Facebook. Some may choose not to ever be on the computer, and that's fine. But part of being in the mass media in a modern age is knowing that everything you do on the computer, they are mining data. Now, we have a message from Jim who says, you have to respect Google for not weighing in, period, though their manager was involved and allowed his involvement in Egypt to transpire as it would if he were not a Google employee. Absolutely. Google is actually an amazing kind of a company. It's one of those things where, from my understanding, they promote community service, they want their people to be involved, and they're very supportive of their employees. Google is a very nice place to work, that I hear when I talk to anybody who works at Google. So yes, they exercised massive restraint. By the same token, it was in their best interest as a company to do so, because if things did not work out well, then they're held harmless. So there's a corporate side, and there's a personal side, and there's our corporate policy. And overall, I think Google came out of this just looking amazing, as they should, because think about how Google has transformed our lives. But let's get back to the curriculum. All of this comes together to create a demographic profile. Now, the demographic profile aggregates a group of people according to a specific set of variables. All right, you may have heard about the Beloit College Mindset List. This comes out every year and is always a bit of a news story because it's fun. So, for example, when we look at college students today, and there they are, and I have a son graduating from UCLA this year, so this list was of particular importance to me. 18 to 24 is the media's most desirable demographic. Now, we're going to be talking about this later because in a lot of ways it doesn't make sense, but overall, it makes absolute sense. So it's a given. It is their most desirable demographic, 18 to 24, men especially. Now, the classes of 2010 and 2011, because last year and this year, were born in the same year that the Harvard Law Review editor, Barack Obama, said that he might actually run for office someday. It's interesting to note. It's also important to note that this year's graduating class grew up drinking bottled water out of minivans and Humvees. They got lost in big box stores regularly. I've been there. They watched wars and revolutions live on television. The child who was graduating UCLA this year sat on my lap watching the news reports of Tiananmen Square when he was a year old. So it's just part of what happens. And by the way, Tiananmen Square is not the site of a revolution. It's where the 2008 Olympics took place. Stadiums, rock tours, and sporting events have always had corporate names to this generation. They're wireless, yet always connected. Barcodes have always been on everything. And food packages have always had nutritional information, whether or not they pay attention to it. Google has always been a verb, as Google this, Google me. Reality shows have always been on television. They've always known that, quote, in the criminal justice system, the people have been represented by separate yet equally important groups. The World Wide Web has been online since they were born. Thanks to MySpace and Facebook, autobiography happens instantaneously. Bad behavior has always been caught on video. When all else fails, they've always had virtual reality. And yes, they've always been searching for Waldo. Now, Waldo is an iconic character, okay? Find what's hidden in this picture. It's one of those things we've always been intrigued by, and this is where children get their fulfillment for that. Waldo is consistent. He always wears the same shirt and hat, and he always hides in plain sight so you can find him, which enables him to be satisfying and fulfilling. He's also become a massive cultural reference in a lot of films. I have seen frequently referenced by characters when looking at a girl with a fella in a red and white striped shirt. Oh, look, she found Waldo. So this is a large part of their cultural vernacular. Now, demographics can be reached through icons like this that are easily recognizable and meaningful to them. Icons are the visual symbols that convey a unified meaning to one or more specific demographics. So there's a lot of different kinds of icons. There's religious icons. Those are the ones we're most familiar with. I've mentioned before that I'm half Greek, and when I first met my grandmother, I was 16 years old, walked past her room, and she was kneeling in prayer before a closet. Seemed kind of odd until she showed me that that's where she kept her icons, so that although she couldn't go to church every day, she could pray to the in front of the icons, and that had meaning for her. It enhanced her religious experience of prayer. Now, it's both Christianity and Orthodox. We also have the political demographics. If you see a donkey near a flag, you know that it has something to do with the Democrats. Same thing with a elephant and the Republicans. Now, there's brand logos that we see regularly, and we understand them immediately. A swoosh, it's Nike. You don't even have to have the name. We not only know it's Nike, but we know that we should just do it. The double arches, the golden arches, are McDonald's. And then we also have what's considered the poster child for something. Poster children are icons. For example, Gloria Steinem. Gloria Steinem became the poster child for the women's movement and for the National Organization of Women. Her sunglasses were iconographical. I remember when I was in college, I had to get the aviator glasses by Polaroid so that they would also be light sensitive, and I'd have my sunglasses or my regular glasses wherever I went. But that was just part of identifying with the women's movement. Cesar Chavez with the United Farm Workers, also an iconographical image. And we identify the movement with the image of this person. So they become what I'm calling the poster children for it. Now, target demographics are an aggregate that can be predicted to positively respond to a specific message. We're going to take a look at a little funny clip now that talks about how detailed some of these target demographics can get. When we come back, we'll talk about the serious aspects. So let's take a look. This is from The Onion.
This Onion News Network tracking poll in the 2008 presidential race. So let's get right to election correspondent Andrew Swanson, now live in the Wharf of the White House Command Center.
It's good to see you, Andrea.
Great to see you. A lot of data to sift through here. What do these numbers tell us?
Well, it looks like the race is really going to come down to which candidate can woo the 430 crucial voting blocks that will be casting their ballots this November.
What are all the factors you're looking at? Age, sex, gender, race, education?
That's right, Andrea. There's also religion, soda preference, drug use, body mass index, number of tattoos, size of television screens, and favorite non-sports pastimes. Of course, the big news this morning is over the battle over the Dunkin' Donuts independence.
Oh, that's right.
That is, yes, the working class swing voters who make under $60,000 a year. McCain was able to gain 3 points with them just this week.
Wow.
You know, time and time again, if we look back, we have seen how
they influence
the Dinty Moore dads, men with multiple illegitimate children who eat single-serving microwavable meals for dinner.
And this is Obama's weak area right now.
That is right. That, and of course, the Corolla in-laws, what the Democrats are losing there, they're rapidly picking up with dental office receptionists who plan on going back to school to get their real estate degree someday.
Right. Now, the Democrats have got a lock on those urban groups like corduroy-wearing homosexuals and people who eat artisanal sandwiches, right?
Yes, that would be a lock.
Okay, let's talk about the 28% of necktie Asians living above frozen yogurt shops. I mean, they're urban, but technically they have more in common with underemployed mathematicians and farmhouse-dwelling self-publishing mystery novel authors, right?
Yes, that is true, Andrea. I think with them it'll come down to, are they going to vote with their wallets, or are they going to vote vote with their conscience. We're also seeing a lot of young people getting involved this year, including the Lost Watching Roommates, the Wes Anderson dipshits, and the Facebook masturbators. Those are very strongly pro-Obama.
Now, what about the employees of the Riggins Idaho, Washington Mutual, and Mark Street who have crushes on that girl, Amy, who works at the Wendy's Next Door demographic? We've been hearing a lot about them.
Yes, Andrea. Well, Josh and Todd have both been polling in favor of Obama, but there is speculation that those figures are off since Amy is also for Obama.
That's
so they may be saying that just to impress her. Once they get in the voting booth, we think they'll go towards McCain, actually, because they're also strongly influenced by the Stoner friend Leo demographic, who will drive them to the polls that day.
So I think we're looking at a win for McCain there.
Yes.
Andrew, thanks so much for being with us and clearing some of this up for
thanks.
Us. It's
Anytime.
Certainly going to be a fascinating race to watch.
Great. We'll see you again. Thanks, Andrew.
All right. You take care. Next up, scientists are predicting a large asteroid movie will hit theaters in the next 2 to 3 years.
So, as you see, it gets into micro-specifics. But think about this. The way that they reach us, whether it's politically or marketing a product, is to know as much as possible about the messages they're going to want to, that we're going to want to receive. If you know that I'm a mother with three sons, you're not going to send me coupons for Barbie dolls, because chances are I'm not going to buy them unless it's a birthday party weekend for someone. But the truth of the matter is that if you look at Clinton with the soccer moms, and how that came about, and how it then transformed with the Republicans to the hockey moms. They put you into a category so that you can also say, well, yeah, I want to identify with them too. My kids didn't play soccer, but I definitely fit the profile of the soccer mom at the time. So it's a marketing strategy. And marketing strategy is the plan to reach a specific target demographic. Now, again, age, gender, income level, race and ethnicity all impact the marketing strategy that a company is going to go after. Every different industry has specific demographics that they want to target. And while specific movies come out in, they're going after that male 18 to 24 demographic, or it's a children's movie, the prime demographic in the entertainment industry is four quadrant. Okay, we're going to take a look at the image here. Let's go full screen on this so they can absolutely see what's here. Okay, the four-quadrant audience is male over 25 and under 25, female over 25 and under 25. Now, this may seem like a great big reach, but basically, they're talking about anything that Pixar releases. It's the blockbuster golden mean. It has the largest common denominator, and it appeals to all demographics. That means big box office, which means a big ancillary income stream. But blockbuster movies like Spider-Man and anything that Pixar produces will have this four-quadrant appeal. And so that's now what the entertainment industry is focused on, because the niche market's not doing so well in the return on investment and time spent. So when we look at the different demographics, we want to, as brands or as people in the advertising industry, find the largest common denominator that can be reached in a way that they want to be reached and in a place where they can be found and marketed directly to. Now, the U.S. Census Bureau generally considers the following demographic birth cohorts based on birth rate, which is statistically measurable, to identify specific generations. Now, we're going to take a look at a generational chart, and a cohort is a group of statistical similarities. So let's go full screen on this so you can see it more clearly. Okay, the classics were born 1900 to 1920. That's when my grandparents were born, and ironically, my father. Long story there. The baby bust was 1921 to 45, and it's divided into two separate divisions, 21 to 33 and 34 to 46. Baby boomers were from 46 to 64, and again divided into two segments, 46 to 57 and 57 to 64. Gen X, the baby bust, which was the second one, born 64 to 76. The baby bust meaning not as large of a birth population. And then echo boomers, born from 76 to 94 and divided into both the leading edge and the trailing edge of echo boomers. Now, these data are cold, hard facts. They are driven by the census. How will they change if we put in intangible variables? This is where psychographics come in. Now, psychographics are really, in a lot of ways, more important than demographics, because the demographics, it's a fact. You may, at the age of 24, you may or may not have chosen a toothpaste brand. But psychographics are about the affinities. They are attributes of personality, values, attitudes, interests, and lifestyles. And when you layer the psychographics on top of the demographics, you get a much more accurate picture of what's going on with the public. Now, these are often referred to as IAO variables because the focus is interests, activities, and opinions. They differ from demographics solely because they have intangible qualities and they focus on affinities. For example, dog lovers. Dog lovers are a psychographic. They differ from cat lovers in personality. I don't know what you do when you have someone who loves dogs and cats and has them both, except you market to them both specifically for those two areas. Psychographics are a marketing tool, pure and simple. And here's the interesting thing. Even churches have marketing consultants. So we're going to look at a quick clip now of the psychographic profile of a group of churches in a small town. Let's take a look.
When we think of the overall concerns of the people in Newcastle, there are five basic categories. The first one is called basics. And the highest concern under the category of basics was maintaining personal health. So that's what the people of Newcastle said was their highest concern under the category of basics. The next category is family. And the highest concern under family was dealing with teen and child problems. The next category is community. And the highest concern under community was neighborhood crime and safety. The next category was hopes and dreams, and the highest concern under this category was achieving long-term financial security. And then the last category was spiritual slash personal, and the highest concern of the people in Newcastle was dealing with stress under the category of spiritual and personal. So dealing with stress was the highest concern there. There was a statement that they asked the likelihood of people agreeing with it, and 94% of the people in Newcastle agreed with this statement. Public education is essential to the future of the American society. And 93% of the people in Newcastle agreed with this statement. It is important to preserve the traditional American family structure. And now, there are some household segments that are established by demographic and psychographic companies. And there are a number of them, and based on the information that they found in this particular city, they established the top three household segments. And so here they are. The number one household segment in the city of Newcastle is what is called surviving urban diversity, and that represents about 21% of the people in Newcastle. These are people that have a high concentration in both young ages and old ages, which is consistent with the demographic information we looked at. Their faith involvement is slightly below the national average, but their belief in God is somewhat above the national average. And their primary concerns are adequate food, abusive relationships, and affordable housing. And the church programs that they would prefer, for the most part, have to do with food resources and daycare. Okay, so that's the surviving urban diversity group. The second highest concentration were what is called the laboring country families, and they represent about 14% of the population in Newcastle, and they're above average in blue-collar employment. Their faith involvement is above the national average. Their belief in God is high. Their primary concerns have to do with divorce, finding spiritual teaching, and abusive relationships. And the church programs that this group prefers have to do with divorce recovery, Bible study and prayer groups, and food resources. So that's the second highest, laboring country families. Then the third highest household segment is called established empty nesters, which isn't surprising given the demographic information in Newcastle. They represent about 13% of the population. Their faith involvement is about the same as the national average. Their primary concerns have to do with adequate food, personal health, health insurance, and companionship. And the church programs that they would prefer are spiritual retreats, food resources, and care for the terminally ill.
You know, I spend about 10 or 12 hours every week looking for the clips that I show, and this is the reason why. When you consider the fact that a tiny little town, thought it was important to get an in-depth psychographic analysis of the people who live there from the point of the churches that have to serve these people. You're at a point of realizing the essential reliance on demographics and psychographics. Now, this information will enable the churches to provide the services that their congregation needs and responds to most positively, and that will help them stay in business, basically, because a church is only as strong as its congregation's size and involvement, actually. So let's re-examine the demographic divides that we saw a minute ago about the generations with the psychographics layered on top of the demographics. Now, the theory of generations has been studied over the last 500 years. And I don't mean that for 500 years people have been studying generations. There have been a number of studies that have looked back over 500 years. And it seems that every 20 years there is a new generation, and it is labeled. So right now we have the millennials. Anybody who's had a child in the last 10 years gave birth in the millennial generation. In 1985, there was an extremely important generational study by Schumann and Scott. And broad samples of adults were asked, what world events are especially important to you? They were able to isolate 33 events that were specifically mentioned most often, and they shaped it into 7 distinct cohorts, which differ from the ones that we recently saw, because this blends the demographics and the psychographics. Now, their study looked at 2 intangible factors, significant memories and key characteristics of the members of the specific generational cohort. A cohort, remember, because this is important to understand, is a group with statistical similarities. So now, when the ages of the respondents were correlated with the expressed importance rankings, 7 distinct cohorts became apparent. It starts with the Depression cohort. These are the people born from 1912 to 1921. Their specific memories, as embodied in this amazing Dorothea Lange photo portrait, were the Great Depression, high unemployment, poverty, and financial uncertainty. They had no idea where their next meal was coming from. They had no idea when it was going to get better. The media wasn't there to tell them employment is down 0.1% this week. So it was kind of a hopeless kind of time where they really had to cling to everything that they were capable of. The key characteristics were a constant striving for financial security throughout their entire life. They were risk adverse. They knew that they needed to hold on to what they had and developed a waste not, want not attitude. And they strove for comfort because life in the Depression was so hard and there were so few comforts available to them that they went out of their way to look for comforts, but in a value-added situation, because waste not, want not. You didn't want to overspend on anything. Now, the pre-World War II cohort was born from 1922 to 1927. This was the age that grew up to understand you bought war bonds to support the effort. Their significant memories were central around men leaving to go to war and many not returning. The personal experience of war, the loss, the worry, the fear. Women working in factories for the first time, and the focus on defeating a common enemy. The environment that my grandparents were young adults in was surrounded by this as they started to raise their first child, their only child, actually, on my mother's side. And the key characteristics were the nobility of sacrifice for the common good, patriotism, massive patriotism, and being a team player. The rah-rah American sentiment was enormous. And so everywhere we turned, it was buy war bonds, support the efforts, give up your nylons, give up any medal you have for the war effort. We have to support our troops. And that's something we really haven't seen since World War II. Now, the World War II cohort, born from 1928 to 1945, had a different experience. Their significant memories were of the sustained economic growth after the war, social tranquility. There was the Cold War, but it really wasn't something that you had to be involved in, just aware of. You didn't have to give up for the Cold War. You did have to look over your shoulder. And there was also McCarthyism. Again, neighbor turning on neighbor. In the Hollywood industry, it was especially devastating with the Hollywood blacklist of people being identified as communists. And it was also the early emergence of the drug culture in this generation. Key characteristics were conformity, conservatism, and traditional family values. This is the generation that created the nuclear family of the 50s image, which is something that I hold near and dear because I think it's a very aspirational thing to go toward. But it was definitely what led to the baby boomer cohort, number one. Now, number one was from 1946 to 1953, and the people born at this time had significant memories of assassinations, JFK, Bobby Kennedy, Martin Luther King, political unrest. It was the early days of Vietnam War, man's first walk on the moon. We had tragedy, and we had huge, huge hopes we were going to reach into space. The Vietnam War counterbalanced with anti-war protests, the social experimentation, and the sexual freedom. This was a time where this generation experienced the civil rights movement, the environmental movement, the women's movement. There were protests and riots, and experimentation with recreational drugs emerged first in this generation, this cohort. Key characteristics of the cohort were they were experimental and individualists. They were free-spirited, but they also had a huge social conscience, and they became very cause-oriented. Okay, now the baby boomer cohort number two, born 1954 to 1965, this is my generation, you can figure out where, their significant memories were quite different. Watergate, Nixon resigning, the Cold War, the oil embargo, raging inflation, disco, which was not a great thing to have to listen to, but we embraced it, and gasoline shortages. Okay, at the time, gasoline was 29 cents a gallon, and I know because I had to fill up my Ford Pinto, as we remember those cars, once a week when I was in college. But this was a time of changing. We had gone from that hopefulness to key characteristics of being less optimistic, pragmatic, and generally cynical. Now, I like to pride myself on the fact that I think I'm an optimist, but the generational trends were counter to that. Generation X was born from 1965 to 1980. That's the imager of the Challenger, because that's a major symbolic, significant memory for this generation. We had won the race to space. We had done amazing things. We had gotten so used to the shuttle going up and down that most people didn't even watch it on TV. And then it exploded. We had the Iran-Contra affair. We had Reaganomics. AIDS emerged. Star Wars. MTV came around. Much better music than disco, thank you. Personal computers were starting to build into this generation's daily existence. Safe sex, on the other hand, was a byproduct of the AIDS awareness. Divorce, single-parent families, they all became more prevalent. And the end of the Cold War, with the fall of the Berlin Wall, was huge. But then shortly after, they had to deal with Desert Storm. Now, the key characteristics of this generation are a quest for emotional security. No kidding. Look at all the different things they experienced in all the different directions. They're independent, somewhat informal, and very entrepreneurial because they have understood the importance of Steve Jobs and Wozniak on the world and how two kids in a garage with a little spunk transformed the way that we live our daily lives. Generation Y's cohort was from 1981 to 1999. This is the very connected demographic. They had significant memories of the rise of the internet. 9/11 happened, and they were completely connected to it. Cultural diversity became the norm, and they were growing up with wars in both Iraq and Afghanistan. Key characteristics are they've become very acceptant of change. They're technologically savvy, and they are also focused on the environmental issues. And they have so much awareness of everything because of this technological connectivity. Now, it's important to note that most of these demographic information segments are culturally based. So this was specifically designed in a study that was directed at North America, and it's applicable in most parts of Western Europe. However, for the rest of the world, we have to take into account that if you were part of the pre-World War II cohort and you grew up in Japan, you had a much different opinion about the World War II than someone growing up in our country would have. Now we have to move into the world of shifting demographics. We're going to take a quick look at the demographic divide, and when we come back, we'll talk about it.
Demographer and Population Reference Bureau, Washington, D.C. The demographic divide, as we call it now, is something that developed in the latter half of the past century, when population growth shifted almost completely into the developing countries. So today, when we look at population growth, it's taking place in Africa, Asia, Latin America, but very little, actually almost none, is taking place in Europe today. Only the United States of the developed countries really has significant population growth, but even that is due to immigration and also births to new residents, birth to immigrants. In fact, here in the U.S., we have our own population, our own demographic divide. Between now and the middle of the century, what we used to call, and I think still do call, the majority population, which goes by a fairly complicated moniker of white non-Hispanic, will not grow at all. This is the traditional European heritage population of the U.S. It simply stopped growing. All the population growth in the U.S. over the next 40, 50 years will come from minorities. Groups we today call minorities, and I doubt in 2050 that we'll be doing the same thing. In the U.S., about half of immigrants come from Latin America. No surprise. I mean, it's a neighbor, and of course, many of those come from Mexico. And their labor is needed. It's needed in agriculture, it's needed in construction, and a lot of other manual labor. The other half of our immigration comes from basically Asia is one of the big sources. And as is almost always true with long-distance migrants, these tend to be well-educated, professional-type people, doctors, professors, scientists, not all, but for the majority. And yes, we still do get some immigrants from Europe, and that stream has not yet stopped. But that is really who's changing the face of the U.S. at the moment, is you have agricultural laborers coming from the nearby countries and professional people coming from further away.
So, as we see, the demographics are shifting. By 2050, people are estimating that the majority population of the U.S. will no longer be white, Caucasian. However, the interesting thing to note is that so many systems build up around demographics and then are resistant to change. For example, in the Los Angeles Unified School District, school busing, which started in 1972, when so many of the schools on the west side were 75 to 100% white population, now the entire population of LA Unified School District is less than 9%. However, the busing still continues because that's the system that has been set up. And it's a big frustration to a lot of people who are parents. I'm no longer with my kids in LA Unified. But the fact of the matter is, taking that money off of the streets not only saves the air, but it also could be used to make local schools better, which would build greater community among specific demographics. But try to break down a system once it started. So that's the dark side of demographics. When systems are created to suit a certain need of a demographic that is going to be shifting and changing. Now, demographic segmentation is important because the goal of segmentation is to discover segments of the population that have unmet needs. Because once you can identify an unmet need of a certain part of the population, you can serve it with your product or service. And then you market to that demographic. One of the things that comes out of this is considered to be an opportunity algorithm. That's mathematically calculated scores for an innovation outcome. In other words, if we do this with a specific demographic, with this amount of money, with this amount of awareness, we will get the following result. Marketers use the opportunity score around which to segment a market because their goal is to streamline efficiency to get the largest return on investment. One target demographic, for example, represents more than 60% of all of the purchasing power in the United States. It's the biggest demographic, and it's the most diverse psychographic. Can you guess what it is? We talked about males 18 to 24 being the golden mean for what marketers are looking for. Not them. It's the moms. Sorry, moms control somewhere between 60 and 80% of all purchasing power in this country. I'm going to stay with the 60% because it's more conservative, but I think it's a lot higher than 80%. Now, with moms being the biggest purchasing power, we can look at it humorously. My husband likes to think that my two favorite questions are, will that be cash or credit, or do you want paper or plastic? The truth of the matter is that women do most of the shopping, or they influence the shopping decisions for their families. Now, moms coexist with kids. Once that bond is created, you are in perpetuity, tied to that child in the role of mother. My sons are 19, 22, and 24. They are still my children. I am still purchasing most of the items that they consume. If not that, I am directing them towards certain things. If moms are indeed the biggest purchasing demographic, one has to ask, why is there so much focus on the male 18 to 24? Take a look at this picture. Now let's look at the next one. They're easy to get to. They're spontaneous. They buy on impulse, and desire drives their decisions on what they're going to purchase. These guys in the background, who are a fraternity celebrating, albeit, you know, it's a party, they have a studious side as well, we can hope, or at least their parents will, in denial, say, oh yeah, no, they're not always like that. But the truth of the matter is, they're probably not looking at consumer reports to see which microwave got the best ratings. They're going to grab the one that's cheapest, or they're going to grab the one that's available to them, or they're going to grab the one that comes in red. So they're not comparison shopping or clipping coupons the way moms are. And so moms are a little more difficult to reach. Now, we're going to talk about the images of moms and kids in media, and I'm going to start with something that's a bit sad. This image is of the Coreys. Corey Haimes, Corey Feldman. They were in a movie called The Lost Boys. They were two of the biggest child stars, and one of them died tragically young. Now, there's no warning labels on child actors, and I have very strong opinions on this. If there was a warning label, it might say, feed adequate nutrition, handle with care, do not place in close proximity with drugs or alcohol. But there is none of that. There is the use of the image, the exploitation of the image of the child, and that filters down to the way that real children perceive. We're going to talk about the complicated life of child actors later in this hour, but first we're going to examine the way that the roles that these kids play is, in fact, influencing the roles that mothers and children play in real life. Now, for example, in this movie behind me, Corey Feldman was onto the fact that there were indeed vampires in his town, and he was going to have to save them. And the kids had to deal with this on their own because mom and all the other adults around were incapable of accepting the truth or managing it effectively. Now, I have three sons who grew up watching television and feature films, and at many points in their life, they really wanted to live in the world they saw on screen. So I became the bad guy because I had to be the no monster. No, you can't do it. No, that's not as cool as it looks. No, there are much more dangerous things to consider about that. It happens to all of us, and here's where we start. The mother and child, the Madonna. The role of mother is really the oldest profession in history, and it's not to be confused with the second oldest profession. But mothers have a huge, huge responsibility. Whether it's 2,000 years ago when life was much, much rougher, or today, it is the most complicated job description in the world. And all that is at stake is the health, safety, and well-being of the next generation. So it's a very complicated role that we play, and it's been made more complicated by the media. We're going to take a quick look at some reflections on motherhood by young mothers and what they wish they knew before they had babies. Let's take a look.
I am days away from change, a new place to rest my head, a place to rearrange. I am days away from waving goodbye to my friends. I am days away from change, from one last touch until the next time. change. Well, I have days away from change.
I really like this clip because it just says it all from the points of view of the mother. And the most important statement made in that is that imperfect is the new perfect. Because the media keeps pushing us to be perfect, be our best. Remember all the things we learned in the session about advertising? Well, with mothers, it's even harder because they're constantly pushing you to do more, to do better, no matter how hard you're working. And the big question to ask is, does our society place enough value on the role of the mother? This is essential to look at because if they are indeed 60% of the buying power, they're at least that much of the influence in the world. So why then is motherhood in the media so closely tied to the kitchen? I mean, indeed, mothers nurture their family. We feed them, we protect the children, we keep the house, we take care of everybody when they're sick, even when we're sick too. But advertisers promote the products that enable mothers to do all those things. Food, cleaning supplies and paper products, clothing, furniture, household goods, household expendables. So that when we think about the modern American mothers, we have to go back to the influence of the World War II cohort. Well, we had a different view of Rosie the Riveter. I think it's important to look at her in more dimensions than just that muscular pose we always see. World War II took mothers out of the home for the first time and put them into the workforce. They had to work for the war effort, and they had to support their families when their husbands were away overseas. And for many, unfortunately, who were making the transition into then being single mothers in a post-war society. It created an erroneous sense of abandonment in the minds of the children. Mom was no longer home all the time. So we saw the earliest latchkey kids. Look at this little girl looking over her shoulder cautiously. She's fearful. And the latchkey child was a big part of the baby boomer generation because so many of the mothers had to or chose to work outside the home. So these children learned to do without constant supervision. At many instances, they developed a sense of lack or wanting. But even in today's society, where the kids are waiting, it's 3 o'clock, where's my mommy? Everybody else has been picked up. You know, when I look at my children, they frequently say, you know, all of their friends have all this independence because their parents aren't home from work yet. And I would say that when their friends were in therapy saying, my mother was never there for me, my children could be in therapy saying, she was always there. I could never get away with anything. What I did in staying home to take care of my children was an anomaly in the modern world. It wasn't necessarily by choice. I had a son with multiple disabilities and had to, for his sake and for the ability of him to thrive and survive. But most mothers, at some point or another, have or will go back to the workforce, and if not that, to children, to charity work. And so after the war, women returned to the homes with a new sense of independence, and they learned that they had been able to be self-sufficient. And other women around them felt the same. So the independent woman was no longer a fish out of water. And as boomers grew, the role of the mother started to shift more. It heralded the beginnings of the women's movement in the 1960s. Now we're going to take a look behind me at what I like to call the founding mothers. Gloria Steinem, Bella Abzug, Shirley Chisholm, and Betty Friedan. When I was a child in the 60s, these women were my heroes. Because they promised a future that no one else was offering me. They promised independence. They promised equal rights. We're going to take a look at Gloria Steinem as she suggests that we each do one outrageous thing each day. Let's take a look at this clip.
Therefore, at the end of lectures, when you've had this great organizing meeting and people are full of energy, but the question is what is going to happen the next day, I started to make an organizer's deal with people. I said, okay, if you promise me that in the next 24 hours you will do at least one outrageous thing in the cause of simple justice, I don't care what it is, only you know what it should be, you know, can be as simple as saying, pick it up yourself, or deciding to run for office, or telling everybody your salary and suggesting the whole office share their salary so you can see who's getting discriminated against. It's up to you. You decide what it is. And if you do this, I promise you that I will do one outrageous thing tomorrow, two in that 24 hours, and I guarantee you at least two results. One is that by the day after that, the world will be better. And the second is that you will have such a good time that you will never, ever again get up in the morning saying, will I do an outrageous thing? Just which outrageous thing am I going to be to do today? So my hope for this video is really the same. I hope that everybody watching it will do at least one outrageous thing tomorrow and the next day and the next and the next.
The women's movement ushered a complete shift in the psychographic profile of women. Okay, the new trend, women worked out of the home. They did it to find personal fulfillment, and they did it to help their families because financial needs required that. It gave women permission. And once women were given permission, they were able to talk about themselves, and they were able to put themselves first, at least sometimes. Our bodies ourselves was pivotal, because suddenly women were talking about their bodies. And naturally, there was a backlash to the women's movement. It's essential to understand this. How bad was it? Well, let's see the image. Yeah. The new F word was feminist. And it's partially because we're very resistant to change, especially with men. It promotes the fight or flight, and it goes against our natural rhythm. But also because we fear the unknown. There was no historical reference for women being in the workforce in a non-war society. And some women also feared this because if they tried, if they went into the workforce and did not succeed, how would they be able to come back if the experiment didn't work? Latchkey kids continued to be more prevalent, and it became the accepted norm, and it was also a bit of a joke, revenge of the latchkey kids. There were social concerns about it, and so after-school programs sprung up, and they served the needs. And in a lot of ways, it was better because kids had organized sports on the playground. They had after-school tutoring. They had social. They had snacks. They had things to do that kept them out of trouble. Now, by Generation X, television had become the electronic babysitter. Working mothers came home to housework, and letting the kids watch TV gave them time to do that, or it just gave them time to do some rest. The TV series still promoted what had transformed from the 1950s image of June Cleaver and Donna Reed, you know, vacuuming and cooking in the Pearls, to the Brady Bunch. Now, there was a little fantasy twist, because if you look at the Brady Bunch, a mom with three daughters, a dad with three sons, and who's at the center of the family? The housekeeper. Now, in this new fantasy twist, Mrs. Brady is the mom with household help, but Mrs. Partridge in the Partridge Family was the new fantasy model of the working mother. She could be in showbiz, but she was there with her kids. In a chaotic and changing world, it was comforting to remember the life that may or may not have ever been in the 50s. And so there's an innate desire to imagine that this security and comfort existed in the past, and advertisers started to rely on that in their cultural memory as they created our desire for household products. TV advertising ushered in the TV dinner because we were spending more time around the TV. Well, let's see this quick clip from Swanson Foods in the 1970s.
Swanson announces new three-course frozen dinners, the most complete frozen meal ever put in a single package. Complete from soup to dessert. It's the new Swanson three-course dinner. Gives you meat and vegetables plus soup and dessert. Here's the three-course turkey dinner. First course, Campbell's cream of tomato soup, hot and tempting. Second course, tender juicy slices of turkey, only the breast and thigh meat, with tasty dressing, fluffy whipped potatoes, and green peas in butter sauce. Third course, sweet and spicy apple crisp for dessert. It's the first and only three-course frozen dinner. Look for Swanson three-course dinners at your grocers, where you also find Swanson TV brand dinners. Get turkey, Salisbury steak, or fried chicken. Remember, you can trust Swanson.
I misspoke. That clip is from the 60s. But having had to eat those TV dinners, I assure you that they were not any more or less appealing. They were not any more appealing in full color. Advertising reached out to fill the emotional void, emotional void in our lives with their products and their services. Okay, mom became the target demographic, but they didn't quite respect her enough yet. The intent was to placate moms with the idea that their products were making our lives a little bit better. Let's take a look at that dinner in color, okay? The reality was that there was a huge loss in the quality of our life. No matter what you want to say about this food behind me, it's not the same as if mom cooked it herself. But the promise of leisure time was there, even though it turned out to be a lie. And the family dinner table became the exception rather than the rule, even though the dinner table has always been the traditional place where families come together to communicate and to bond at the end of a day, where they all go off in different directions. The image of Norman Rockwell's dinner, while appealing, I have to say that as the daughter of a single mother, I was raised by my grandparents and my maternal great aunts. And the central rooms of their home were indeed the kitchen and dining room. And we prepared meals together and we sat down and ate them together. But there were other extenuating factors in both directions. My great aunt was an antique appraiser and her living room was filled with 18th century antiques. You don't let children play in there. And frankly, children don't want to play in there. So it's easier to constantly be in the dining room kitchen area. My grandmother's home, the television was always visible from the kitchen and from the dining room, and it was always on. So even though we had some of the sensibilities, it still wasn't this idealized vision, which raises another controversial question. Was it in the best interest of our social development to allow the media to diminish the role of the mother in our culture? Okay? Modern life has become a constant balancing act. I always equate it to juggling flaming knives while walking a tightrope over a tank of sharps with a baby and a snuggly. We have issues of daycare, nannies and housekeepers, after-school programs, overscheduled children, competitive sports building competitive children, not to mention the PTA fundraising obligations we all wind up with. And if anybody wants to buy some wrapping paper, I probably still have some rolls left in the back of my closet. The media responds to every single market opportunity. And why shouldn't they? There are books, The Working Mother on the Run Manual. Okay? The dilemma that has been raised is, you can do it all, but frankly, you can't do anything right. Now, the rise of the suburbs coincided with this part of the women's movement, because as mothers worked outside of their home, and we learned how quickly Levittown was built last week when we saw it go up in a single day, the suburbs moved women farther and farther away from the urban centers where the better jobs were. So when these women were working, they were taking minimum wage jobs, blue collar jobs, or the classic pink collar jobs, teacher, teacher's aide, nurse. They were not in the areas where the most highly paid work could be found. And that was fine to a lot of people because the battle for equal pay for equal work still had not, and gosh, it still has not been resolved. It's a double bind. Society pressured you to become dinks, that's double income couples, while it confined you to a limited range of professional opportunities. When the working mother became the norm, products were developed to support her dual function. Advertising designed the revised role of the mother in society with divided attention. New products or old products repackaged for your convenience were in the new sales pitch. Advertisers still driven by the profit model, and mothers, frankly, were frequently driven to drink. Now, think about, this is funny, the new Prozac and the Tide bottle, but think about all the ads you see on TV for pharmaceuticals. Depression, ADD, ADHD, sexual dysfunction, headaches, allergies. Is there a connection between these maladies and the rise of time or the decrease in time that mothers spend with their children? Now, I've told you, I was the anomaly. I was the stay-at-home mother. And advertisers know that we tend to be the influencers because the working mothers will go to the mothers who stay at home and say, what should I do? Still with the quest for the golden demographic of the 18 to 24-year-old male because it's hip, cool, and edgy, they've now labeled us as desperate housewives. How many real women live the life that we see on Wisteria Lane? And why are housewives desperate today? Well, All moms reside on the threshold of a door, and it can open at any single moment, unexpectedly, and whoever walks through that door is going to have something that will distract you from what you're trying to do at that moment, and you have to do it well and then get back on track to what you were doing in the first place. So when you combine the demands of home with the demands of the workplace, it is no wonder that women are turning to antidepressants, sleep aids, and hormone supplements. Now, the media promotes dysfunction around the role of frazzled mothers. It is, you can't rely on this woman. She can't deliver, certainly not without their products, and mothers are a bother. Talk about the concept of a button pusher. Is it any wonder that women have so much trouble relating with their mothers-in-law, who, for a great part, were stay-at-home mothers or were self-made women who did upper-level jobs, especially in the media? Now, there's a subtle implication that our mothers should have prepared us better, or at least warned us about the impossible demands of the situation. But in a world where ageism is rampant, what's happened to the role of a mother when she becomes the grandmother? We are told that the older woman, it is not desirable to be with or to be the older woman. And so here you have Gloria Steinem, God bless her, at 50, saying, if women would admit to being 50, then people would see that being 50 is not so bad after all. And because she was one of my heroes, the day I turned 50, I started telling people. And now I continue to say that I have turned 50. You can guess how long ago. The media perpetuates this fear of growing old because they're going to sell us products that help prevent the aging process. Isn't that convenient? Now, you can't discuss the role of motherhood without the related element of fertility. When all these messages about how hard and how complicated and demanding it is to be a mother, how many of the women experiencing fertility are actually experiencing emotional ambivalence that is impacting their ability to become pregnant or to take the right steps to become pregnant? And what are we to do when we have a backlash in the role of the tiger mom? This has been all over the media in the last few weeks. This is a mom who's a professor at Yale, and those are her two perfect daughters. They have never had sleepovers. They don't get play dates. They've both had to play both violin and piano. They have had to be A students because she will only accept their absolute best from them, and she knows that they're perfect. Now, what happens to the mother who's overwhelmed, who now someone else hands her this book and says, here's the new norm? How does she cope when she's already unable to cope? And what happens to her kids? I look at these two children, and I think it's ironic that a professor at Yale never read the study at the Harvard Business School that says the A students wind up working for the C students, which is not to say that I'm not proud of my A students. However, the reality is, at what point do these children realize that sometimes even being perfect is not enough, and they're going to have problems that cannot be resolved by perfection, by total dedication, and when they realize at some point what they missed out on? The way that we present parents in media promotes dysfunction in parents. It just does. How do these factors contribute to the way that children respond to their own parents in real life? And how do these factors impact the way that parents respond to their own children in real life? Again, it's not just the parents' dysfunction in media. The way that we present children in media promotes dysfunction in children. Now, we are constantly faced with the image of the super mature child. They're characterized as being the de facto head of the family. There's witty dialogue written by adults and put into the mouth of children that encourages other children to model that behavior that, frankly, becomes rude when they're not having it written by professional writers. They're just not as witty as adult comedy writers are, and so the jokes fall flat. Now, what happens when the super mature child is presented as a positive role model? Let's go back and take a look at the early days of Lindsay Lohan. Please watch this clip carefully and listen for what she has to say about what she wants to do in the future. Let's take a look.
First, it's Tina, and I'm here with Parent Trap star Lindsay Lohan. Now, let me start by asking you, what's it like to play two different characters?
Well, I just thought how proper one was, and then how, like, calm and, like, cool and, like, one was ready to hang out.
This is Grandfather. He's so cute. What do we call him?
Grandfather? Why didn't I think of that?
This is Martin. He's our butler.
We have a butler?
Can you do the two different voices for us?
Well, Hallie talked, like, kind of slang and everything, and then Annie, she talked like this, very proper, with an English accent. So that's how, basically, how it was, the change and everything.
Surfers, do you have any questions for Lindsay?
How'd you react when you found out you got the part?
Oh, my gosh, I started jumping up and down on the bed in my hotel room, and I was freaking out. I called everyone up. I called all my friends and everything. It was so exciting because I never thought that they would come.
What scene was the most fun to act in?
There was this one scene that I really had a lot of fun doing. It was in a pool, so I guess you know how fun that would be. It was with Elaine Hendricks, who plays Meredith.
Sorry, did I get you wet there?
Just a little, Hal.
And it's a scene where I'm, like, telling her, like, where to go and everything, so that was pretty fun. I got to change my attitude.
You want the 411?
What's the 411?
The lowdown on other women. It's always the same routine. Horseback riding through the vineyards, romantic dinners with his special reserved red wine.
Here we go. A bottle of my special reserve lid. So, did you girls find something to talk about while I was gone?
What was the messiest scene in the movie?
Well, there's a scene where the two characters are, like, very mad at each other.
Ladies, it's time to break up this little love fest.
And, Hallie, she is gonna, go into Annie's bunk at night, and she's gonna put, like, all this, like, junk in her bunk. And, actually, Annie, she steps out of her bed, and she steps into this trap, and this humongous, like, water balloon, like, at least 1 pound, is, like, falls right on her head. And that's for the thumbtack in my hair and the wig. That balloon would pop and not hurt me. So that was pretty fun, and that was really messy.
That girl is without a doubt the lowest, most awful creature that ever walked the planet.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
What's your favorite subject in school?
I like creative writing because I like to write. I want to grow up and I want to write and everything and go to college and then do what I have to do with acting.
Think about that. I want to write, go to college, and then do what I have to do with acting. Okay, look at where she began. Cute little child. She was still a child then. And look at where she's wound up. Okay? Who would she be if she had gone to college right now? And where's Lindsay's mom? Well, Lindsay's mom is often in the back of, that's Lindsay's mom. Can you tell the difference between her and Lindsay? Now, it's easy to blame Lindsay Lohan for bad behavior because she's 24, she's got money, she's got opportunity, and she's making bad choices. But every story about Lindsay has a second half, and that second half is Dina Lohan. Where was she when Lindsay was making the bad choices, and what did she do in the aftermath of the bad choices besides saying, oh, she doesn't have a problem? Dina Lohan got a reality program called Living Lohan, and it features her with her three other kids. Now, we're going to watch a quick clip of her interviewing on the red carpet, the stars, the adult stars of Georgia Rules, and then her daughter. And I want you to take a close look at the nonverbal cues you can pick up and try and see if you can figure out how these adult stars feel about Dina Lohan and feel about talking to her on the red carpet. Let's take a look.
And just across town, more stars, more flash bulbs, and our secret weapon on another red carpet. Lindsay Lohan's mom, Dina, takes you to her daughter's movie premiere, Georgia Rules.
Hi, Mom.
Hi, honey.
E.T., Lindsay and me. I've got the questions only a mother can ask. So I interviewed Jane and the whole cast. Did you learn anything from Jane?
So we're talking to you like this.
I just know have to say that, by the way. Awkward.
Lindsay looked lovely in a strapless Jill Stewart, while Dina made her debut as an E.T. special correspondent dressed in Dina Burrell couture with a Lauren Merkin clutch and Mimi So diamonds. Lindsay thrilled her eager fans, but what excited Dina? Seeing Felicity Huffman.
Does she eat?
I am wearing Carmen Mark Valvo.
Absolutely. You look gorgeous.
You're so tiny in person.
Jane Fonda came to the E.T. platform.
Young Hollywood stars of today, it's so difficult with all the tabloids and paparazzi. And what was your advice?
It's not a dress rehearsal. This is it.
Okay,
but you screw it up now, you don't get another chance.
Jane made me cry today. She's the nicest things about me, so it felt really good. That's wonderful. I talked to Felicity about Desperate Housewives. You know Mommy watches it. Are you a fan of Desperate Housewives?
Oh, of course I am.
She's so sweet. She's so tiny in person. I was, like, shocked. I love her. She's so adorable.
And we're being really serious right now, and it's really awkward. And I love you. Can I give you a hug?
And with a whisper saying, Mom, you did great, Lindsay was off.
This was so much fun. Thanks, Mary.
Okay, Dina Lohan has made comments about she was in the entertainment industry and then Lindsay just kind of slipped right into it. But I was on IMDb Pro last night and I can't find a single credit for Dina Lohan before Lindsay had her career. Which brings us to the point of media images pressure children to emulate the children and behavior they see on screen, online, and on print. If that child is parenting the parent, who's parenting the child? A child serving as the adult poses the dilemma that is stripping the child of childhood, and the results of that are tragic. It's not noble. Now, we acknowledge the fact that children are becoming more and more mature at an earlier age, and we have to manage that maturity in a way that enhances the child's experience rather than detracts from it. But the media also has to provide better role models for kids, and when the media discusses the problem, it does not offer effective solutions. So children should not feel that it is right or good for them to be the adult in the family, and they should not drive the income of the family. I'm going to say that again. Children should not drive the income of a family. The dramatic element of conflict in a story, that fictional characters should be dysfunctional, enables for a heartwarming moment at the very end of it. Okay, in real life, problems ensue when kids try to handle things themselves. All right? When no writer is there to put the words into the actor's mouth, the child's mouth, when no director is there to stop the cameras before the trauma and the emotion become too much to bear and the jeopardy becomes too severe, and no deus ex machina flies in to save the day, there's no laugh track to punctuate the warm moments of irony. Kids turn to the media for solutions to their problems. In real life, suffering is on a significant scale. Alcohol and drug abuse and addiction, sexual promiscuity, divorce, and infidelity. All of these things are rampant. We have parents fighting in front of children all the time. Look at those children trying not to see or hear what's going on, but they know. And then adolescents model dysfunctional behavior, because dysfunctional adolescents are at very high risk of emulating dysfunctional parental behavior. We know, for example, Lindsay Lohan's parents were divorced. We can't make any allegations or assumptions, but we can wonder how much of that impacted her life. Dysfunctional adolescents who avoid becoming dysfunctional adults are frequently drawn to them because they understand and have developed a tolerance to it. And that's why they say many children who were abused grow up and marry abusive husbands. Now, they become enablers, which is actually, in some level, a loving act, and they perpetuate dysfunctional cycles. When the family structure starts to break down, adolescents turn to gangs and inappropriate influences because they need to create that sense of family. Look at this lonely kid lying in bed on his computer, presumably on a social network. This is not a good thing for kids at risk. Facebook friends are not a substitute for real friends. Some teens don't have the skills to connect in real life, and some teens are just much more vulnerable than others. So they're turning to social networking sites to connect with other human beings, and they're connecting with other kids who are just as dysfunctional as they are. Constant exposure to dysfunctional adolescents results in all of them supporting each other's dysfunctions. And what will happen to them when their Facebook friends aren't enough? Now, constant exposure to dysfunction enables the perception that dysfunction is the norm. The biggest exposure to media dysfunction is on the child actor. Let's take a look at the new potential train wreck, Miley Cyrus. Imagine you're 11 years old. Every day you get to go to work with some of the biggest stars in television, and you are indeed a star. Everybody treats you like a star. Everybody says, yes, yes, of course, to whatever you want. You like those shoes, the company will give them to you for free. You want to go here, we can arrange for you to do it. You want to eat at this restaurant, you'll get the best table. There is always someone to pick after you. No, no, leave it there, I'll get it. Then every night, because you're a child, you go home to your family. And if you have good parents, they try to treat you like a real kid. They say, please pick up after yourself. Please help do household chores. Siblings, of course, will have whole other issues with the fact that you are a star and they are not. And then the neighborhood kids treat you differently. And the neighborhood parents treat you differently. When one of my sons was very little, his best friend was one of the largest television stars and movie stars out there. And I would literally be appalled watching parents on the schoolyard sucking up to this kid as if he was a celebrity instead of a seven-year-old. So if you're in this mess, which family are you more drawn to? The TV family where everyone's cool and hip and wonderful and treats you like a star, or the family that you go home to? How can child actors manage the psychological dilemma of having that warm and nurturing perfect family at work and then coming home to a family that may be placing what they feel are unreasonable demands on them to be normal? Now, what happens to the child whose parents then become their managers? Okay? Now, the parent is not trained to be a professional decision maker, and they make choices for the child. So let's say they pick a show or a movie that turns out to be a flop, and the other one they might have chosen was a huge success. How do the children survive emotionally if they never get another option for major success? Let's assume that hypothetical 11-year-old I was talking about now is the 14-year-old. They're not so cute anymore. They aren't getting more jobs. Nobody's saying yes to them anymore. They're not getting free stuff, and, wow, their agent or manager drops them, presumably not the parent manager. How are the children then supposed to deal with the emotional devastation that accompanies the kind of rejection that is frequently too often for adult actors? What happens if the child wants to stop and the parent's saying, no, you can't because you're our primary income? And one of the things that has just appalled me in being in the entertainment industry is seeing there are parents who want it so badly that they will literally separate, and one of the parents will come out with one of the children while the other parent stays back with siblings, and the pressure is on this child. You've got to get the career so that it makes all of this world worthwhile. And they live in the Oakwood Village apartments over by Burbank. It's almost packed with them, and they all have the same thing going on. No one is considering separation anxiety, sibling rivalry, or the issues of abandonment that are attached. So then we look at someone like the Olsen twins. When I saw the Olsen twins for the first time in real life, they were 11, and I was seated next to them at a awards dinner. And I was told, you're sitting with children, and imagine my surprise to see I wasn't with children. I was with two human beings that seemed to be devoid of childhood, with their handlers, not their parents, their handlers. Now, what happens in a situation like this? Because from early on, one child got the camera time, and this happens with twins frequently. One gets the camera time and one is the stand-in. And even though they have the same kind of aspirations, they're not getting the attention. So, we have children who face enormous challenges, and there isn't a training program or licensing situation for parents who do that. So we have to look at how we can manage this effectively. Not all children have these problems. If you happen to be someone like Taylor Swift and a boy breaks up with you, you write a hit song about it. But for how many other child stars, breakups that would devastate kids in real life when five other people know, and suddenly your relationship breakups are all over Us Magazine and everything else, which is not to single out Us because I think it's one of the better ones, but it's all over the media. What do you do then? Now, it looks like we have a phone call from someone. Am I correct? Hello? Frank is calling from Redondo Beach. Hi, Frank. I can't hear a thing you're saying.
Hello?
Hi, Frank. Hello?
Yeah, hi, this is Frank. I have a question.
Yes. What is it, Frank?
Yeah, hi, I wanted to make a comment about Ron Howard. That seems that would be the exception to the rule. I'm called a little bit, they have me on hold, but you were making reference to all the bad things that happened to child actors, and it seems like Ron Howard would have been the exception.
Ron Howard.
That's what I had to say. Thank you.
Yeah, Ron Howard is definitely an exception. And Ron Howard went from being in a very nurturing environment where his parents were very attentive to the fact that there were different things going on in his life, and they kept him in somewhat of a normal background. And then he had, I think, a slightly normal life through high school, and then came back on Happy Days. And then he decided not to continue as an actor so much as a director. So, yes, there are exceptions to the rules, and many of these kids turn out to be fine. My son's friend is in college now and presumably doing quite well. But the truth of the matter is it's always an iffy situation, and so that's why we talk about trying to be more cautious. If you're going to have a child be in the entertainment industry, proceed with caution, if at all. So now we're going to go into the final lap of this program, and we are going to talk about the ratings. because everything that is done in the entertainment industry is done because of ratings. And they want to make sure they have enough viewers. So you can go to NielsenMedia.com and find out more about it. But the basic is that in 1942, A.C. Nielsen put audiometers in sample homes to see what they were listening to in radio. And when television started becoming predominant in the 50s, then Nielsen moved into that as well. So we're going to take a quick look at a clip from Nielsen executives as they talk about what's the future of the Nielsen ratings.
The future of measurement is all about speed, precision marketing, and data integration.
The future is this sort of marriage of precise consumer market opportunities with precise audience opportunities. You want to collect audience, and you want to develop product that goes after an audience, but now you got to do it across three screens, and you want to get paid for all three screens.
Tomorrow it could be your wristwatch. As long as that signal is being viewed by someone, the technology that we're deploying will allow us to measure it in the future. There's nobody better positioned than Nielsen to be able to provide these insights for our customers.
It's no longer important to pick one medium over another if you're an advertiser. The end game is a more complete, holistic ROI across an entire marketing organization. Are they getting it done across all media? I believe that is the systemic answer we're all hunting for.
Because the world is changing, the industries we operate in are changing, the consumer's experience is really different.
We've seen more change in terms of media technology that has occurred in the last 3 years than the previous 30 years. And that rate of change is going to continue to accelerate as we go forward.
So we take a 5-year plus view on technology, on trends around the world. We've spent years really working with a senior group of clients to come up with a priority set of what Nielsen needed to measure. When we moved to digital television, we started investing in a whole new metering platform more than 10 years ago. So everything we do is about measuring that changing consumer experience.
We've invested very heavily over the past couple of years in resources and in companies which are really dedicated to measuring this new media environment.
The ultimate thing will be connecting all three screens. And so really understanding if a program starts on television or even online and moves to one of the other screens. What's the size of the audience? What's the reach? Is it incremental? Is the behavior different? How does the creative matter? How engaged are you in those different screens?
Each of the three media provide different, distinct, unique experiences to a user. They provide different, distinct capabilities to the advertiser. You can do text-based advertising on a mobile phone. You can't do that on the TV set. You can do search-based advertising on the internet. You cannot do that on the TV set.
Media is bought and sold in different ways on all these platforms. We have decades of experience in understanding the push and the pull between advertisers and media distributors.
We're just at different steps in evolution right now across the three platforms. And I think over the next 2 years, you're going to see a tremendous amount of change in all of those areas.
We're the best in the world in measuring television audiences globally. We're the best in online. And we're soon to be clearly the best in mobile.
Nielsen has taken the lead fusing databases together. We've fused together television and internet data. We've integrated television and consumer data. The real opportunity is really integrating all media databases together in conjunction with consumer databases.
We're looking at the way that consumers consume media in a 360-degree way so that we can give advertisers and media clients a more complete picture of consumer habits. No one measures more online video than Nielsen does. And we are, I believe, the world's experts in doing this.
We've now begun installing internet meters in any of our television households that will permit us to do so. Panel of about 12,000 TV households eventually that also have an internet meter. We also have internet meters in about 30,000 consumer database households. So our plan is to create a foundation of these smaller convergence databases where we measure television and internet, television and print, television and consumer, internet and consumer. Some companies are experimenting with 4G right now. 4G is probably about 10 times faster than the 3G. Importantly, that allows mobile telephones to deliver high-def full-motion videos. There will be more content on mobile devices. Nielsen will measure it in much the same way that we measure online. We can get really rich data through a mobile device.
There's an urgency for change. There's an urgency to value an audience. That's balanced in many clients' minds also by making sure that their research is accurate, that it's projectable, that they understand the implications it has for the business they've already done.
The Council for Research Excellence is made up of a consortium of all of our clients, and they're doing excellent work in terms of studying cross-platform and multimedia exposure. The industry both needs very rapid reaction to change out there, but it also relies on stability over time.
To marry precise markets with precise audience opportunities, all of us, everybody can rally around that. Everybody. And the sooner this all comes together, the better.
So you can see that Nielsen is having to adapt. And we're going to jump really quickly into the next clip, because as new media is pushing them to adapt, the networks are also telling them what their needs are changing into. So this clip is from an NBC Universal executive who's talking about the shift from the overnight ratings to the Live Plus 7. Let's take a look.
What we said a couple of years ago is that you really can't look at what's called, you know, the daily ratings that we get, that's the live plus same day, as indicative. Now, it's a little complicated. Here's the story. We get paid for 3 days. In other words, we get paid for people who watch a program and notably the commercials for the main day of a broadcast, the second day, and the third day. After that, we don't get paid anymore, but we still get ratings for the fourth, fifth, sixth, and seventh day. In other words, what Nielsen does is they measure a program across 7 days. And the reason that it's important from an evaluation standpoint to look at the live 7 rating is because that does tell you the magnitude of the audience. And again, it tells you, I mean, a show like The Office can, you know, have a rating in the threes for its live rating, but it can end in the fives, which it does because of time shifting. And so if you're evaluating the popularity of a program from a program standpoint, you really have to look at live seven, because that's the way people consume TV these days. I mean, overnight ratings are difficult, and honestly, it would be great if they went away, but TV executives need their daily fix, and they need it early, and nobody wants to wait. And so that's one of the problems. So I think we'll always have some indicator of how a program did. But before anybody, you know, either breaks open the champagne or jumps out the window, you need to wait a little bit of time to see what's going on. If you rank order the shows, and this comes from Nielsen, you know, for NBC, The Office is the most time shifted, 44%, Community also 44%. But in that range, ABC's Modern Family, you know, CBS's Big Bang Theory, you know, Grey's Anatomy, Gossip Girl. So, I mean, you know, it's a pretty broad range. It has to be a show people really like, and you can see the shows that I mentioned were shows that, you know, have a pretty good... And also, it tends to be shows that are in competitive environments, like Thursday Night's pretty competitive. And the obverse is true. We know what shows aren't time-shifted. For example, if they are time-shifted, they're played back very quickly. The most obvious one are ones where there's a spoiler factor. So, you know, people don't want to time-shift or wait and store on their DVR, you know, the result of a reality, you know, show. Or if people are going to be talking about the show, a big water cooler show, they want to be able to come in the next day and talk about it. So, you know, we do have some sense about what shows are more likely to be time shifted than others.
Now, I urge you to go to the website for Nielsen Media and look around. They have an amazing glossary that will give you a definition for every possible term and terms you didn't even know existed. So definitely take a look. But I want to go back and add to what we were talking about with Frank a few minutes ago. Because Ron Howard indeed is an anomaly. And he was massively lucky in a lot of ways, but he also had the personal constitution to be able to maneuver and manage all of that. And he chose to remain in the entertainment industry, but a lot of those kids don't. And I want to use the example of Tatum O'Neill. Tatum O'Neill was in a movie called Paper Moon with her dad, Ryan O'Neill. And I was in film school at the time, and I thought it was so innovative because Peter Bogdanovich made an amazing black and white film in the 70s. And it was that whole new generation of filmmakers. And it was wonderful. And at the age of 10, she won the Academy Award for Best Performance by an Actor in a Supporting Role. 10 years old. So then what? Tomorrow, sixth grade? This is a huge, huge shift in perspective. Once a child is directed, is instructed, is taught not to behave like a child, and certainly the entire performance of this role was about the child parenting the adult. So once a child is pushed into that role, how do they slide back into normal childhood? How do you say, well, I'm going to worry about if a boy wants to hold my hand, that's my goal, I'd like to hold that boy's hand. When in fact you've walked the red carpet and you've been treated like an adult, and it's a very, very difficult thing. The best example I can give is that I have a friend, Jeff. He's an editor. He's an amazing film editor. But he started out as a steel worker. Those are the guys who climb around on the steel grids 50 feet above the ground, 50 stories above the ground. I could not imagine doing that. He tells me it was not that hard to become adjusted to. He didn't have to worry about the fear of heights, and he was able to manage it and survive and live to go into a second career. Not everyone is geared to having a childhood as a performer. Some will handle it better than others. Some parents will handle it better than others. I personally, when I was constantly approached by people because I had such cute kids, I said, thank you. I appreciate that you think my kids are cute. No, they don't want careers in television or movies. Thank you very much. Now, we have looked at a number of things today. We've seen demographics and psychographics. We have seen how the combination of the two changes the first in much the same way that Heisenberg's uncertainty principle suggested it would. And now we are left with the learning objectives. Let's take another quick look, because by now, you should be able to discuss the reasons behind audience segmentation by demographics. You should be able to explain the difference between demographics and psychographics, and you should understand how the media portrayal of women and children impacts the role of women and children in society. Now, the next time you turn on your television or your feature film, I want you to pay close attention to what you're watching when you see mothers and children. I also want you to take close look at males 18 to 24 and see what that looks like to you now, too. Thanks so much for joining us. I'm Catherine Clinch. This has been Mass Media and Society, and we'll see you next week.